So, yeah, welcome to my talk. I will talk about infrastructure deployment with GitLab CI, and that's completely containerized, and why you should do this. So, just some slide for introduction. I'm a senior consultant from PandaGender. I'm based in Germany. I'm a blogger, I'm a speaker, IBM Cloud Champion, Docker Community Leader, and to be honest, it's a bit outdated since today in the morning I'm also a GitLab hero. Love anything around Kubernetes, containers, and automation. Yeah, and just a fun fact, my desk is a ping pong table. So, what we'll talk about? First of all, some recap about infrastructure as code, why you should use it, the pros of infrastructure as code, and then some information how and why containerized pipelines can help you fixing some issues. And afterwards, we'll do, yeah, a small step-by-step guide based on an example how you could deploy your infrastructure as containers. So first of all, who of you is already using infrastructure as code? Oh, nice. And Kubernetes? Cool. So we'll do the first slides pretty quick. Then, yeah, infrastructure as code principles. What does infrastructure as a code mean? So it's basically put everything into code, define everything with code, and put it into your Git repository to be able to version your stuff, to be able to rollback your stuff. It's pretty important to also build the code reproducible as well as declarable. So not define the way how things should work to get your target. Just define the target and use tools which help you to go there or to get there. And of course, very important that it's version controlled and completely testable, as well as fully automated. Yeah, so the pros of infrastructure as code. Mainly you, with infrastructure as code, you are able to build immutable infrastructure, which means if you change or deliver a change in your system, you have the option to do this immutable, which means if you live in the container world, you just shut down your container and start up a new version of the container. It's immutable, it's everything is the same. If you scale it, you will have exactly the same container running next to each other. Same for virtual machines. So if you do a config change in your environment and you're running on virtual machines, a config change would mean you're building a completely new virtual machine defined on your configuration, starting up the new machine, shutting down the old machine, and just really run them immutable. Yeah, then of course, with infrastructure as code, you can skip the whole things like Snowflake servers, which means Snowflake server is some kind of server, which is completely different from someone else. So everyone knows such kind of servers. So from a colleague who installed it 10 years ago or 5 years ago, left the companies 2 years ago, it's somehow running. Nobody knows what it's actually doing and how to restart it. So everyone is just hoping, okay, it's running and it's doing something and it's hopefully fine. So with infrastructure as code, everything would have been documented, and with immutable infrastructure, you can would be able to just replace the server. Same for configuration drift, which means you maybe have 10 nodes doing the same stuff. You may be deploying your configuration with scripts, but you're not 100% sure if the script really finishes, if all tasks from the scripts are really done and implemented, and after time you might get some more configuration drift. One server has version A, the other server has version B, because somehow an update didn't work at all. Yeah, with infrastructure as code and immutable infrastructure, you can also fix this one. Yeah, fragile infrastructure basically means you have your whole infrastructure is based on Snowflake servers, which is the best thing you can do. Yeah, and also, of course, everything is documented somehow by itself, which of course does not mean you shouldn't write any kind of comments or readme files or documentation, but at least your configuration is stored within your code, and if you are able to read your code, you at least know the configuration you are doing, you're running out. Of course, comments, README files should help everyone else to understand the configuration. Yeah, so some pitfalls. Of course, you should use some tools which help you to implement your infrastructure as code. It's not really good to do everything on your own, build your own scripts. Even working with immutable infrastructure, it's hard to somehow test everything and get everything right, and somehow find every error which could happen to rollback the stuff. So it's really helpful to use tools. And even more, if you're using tools and tons of different tools for the different use cases, you might end up having your machine installing Terraform, installing Ansible, and all the other stuff. And if your colleague would like to run the same project and build a new version, deploy a new configuration, you're ending up the colleague having, I don't know, like this here, that example, 10 steps to do. Hey, you need Terraform CLI in a specific version. You need somehow a provider which you need to download and copy over in a directory. By the way, the provider is only working with Linux on Windows, so you can't use your Mac. Then you need to configure some SSH keys and doing some other stuff. So it doesn't really help someone to, I don't know, configure 2 hours the local machine to just run a configuration update. So it's pretty important to really automate this, centralize it, and really define the ways how the stuff should work instead of running on a local machine and being the dependency for everyone who would like to roll out a new configuration. Yeah, also you should prevent automation fear, which basically means, yeah, you're not sure what your automation is doing, so it's just a small change. Let's implement it on our own, doing it manually, and then after this small change doing manually, you would never run the automation again because you're not sure which really will happen in your environment. So don't do it at all. Yeah, so just for a basic setup of infrastructure's code. So why should you use containerized pipelines? Basically, because of the same reasons you should run containers at all. So you're able to isolate your different pipeline jobs. So thinking about you have one building node where all your pipeline stuff is running. If you run it in containers, you could really isolate them, put all the dependencies you would like or this pipeline job needs within the container. You somehow are able to scale your pipelines if you're thinking about a Kubernetes cluster and so on. And of course, it's also immutable because every pipeline job, every run starts a new container based on an image and every container looks the same. So it's not having, I don't know, 5 servers which are used for building nodes and you have a configuration drift on them, it's looking nearly the same. Yeah, just as example, here, it's using Terraform. There was a change between Terraform 0.11 and 0.12. Some projects might not run with the older version or the newer version or the other way around. And with containerless pipelines, you can just build a container for the version your project needs and run it. And if you're fine upgrading the Terraform version, just build a new container and everything is fine. And of course, it's not only working with Terraform, kubectl, Helm, Ansible, you name it. Everything is working. So how does it work at all? Just as an overview, we will step down in the later slides. So containerized pipelines means you have every job you define in your pipeline configuration will run in a single container, which means if you have a job which needs Terraform, you will build an image, putting in Terraform, maybe putting in the providers you need for this single job, and build the image, and then use this image. And that image contains everything this single pipeline job needs. If you're lucky, you can perhaps reuse a container for other projects, but even not, it's really one container, one image for this particular job. Yeah, then you have some of the container and would like to run it. How can you do it? And of course, we are somehow working in the Kubernetes world. So the best way to do it is to use the GitLab runner Kubernetes executor, which somehow integrates your CI/CD with your Kubernetes cluster. Which means every job will be scheduled as a pod on your Kubernetes cluster, and within the pod your build container as well as service container will be started. So your whole workload, pipeline workload, is completely moved over into your Kubernetes cluster and can be shared with other workload, your applications, other pipeline, and so on. Yeah, so then we have a second issue, which is how shall I build my container images? We're just talking about, hey, container is everything, but we need some more container images. And it would somehow be great to also build our container images on our Kubernetes cluster. We would like to have our workload. So there is some kind of Docker and Docker. Not sure if you guys know it, which basically means you're building, you're running Docker within your Docker. And it's not really the best solution to do, though there's a project called Kaniko, which you help with the stuff. So let's dig in the different things, topics. So pipeline job image, as I said, it needs to contain everything. You need binaries, libraries, tools, CLIs. Everything is just included. You should also build and rebuild your pipeline mainly automated. So build a pipeline for your pipeline job image container. And think about security fixes. So best way is to define just the versions of your requirements. In this case, it's in line 6. The version of, in this case, YAML-lint I would like to use. And with this, I can define my version and can rebuild this Docker image, I don't know, once a week, once a day, and put in all the latest security issues and security fixes. Yeah. So sorry, it's a little bit small. So this is how you can secure your pipeline. Just make it as small that nobody can read it. No, so basically, it's an example pipeline. You just define the stages as you would do with non-container pipeline. I put in some variables, mainly the pipeline, the container image that I would like to use. And then in the middle part, I'm justifying a tag, in my case Kubernetes, which means my GitLab runner also has a tag Kubernetes, and I tell the pipeline with the tag, hey, please run it on my Kubernetes environment. And then I have an image, which basically defines, in this case, please use the image above, which is the YAML-lint latest version. In this case, I'm overwriting the entry point, doesn't matter in this case, and then run just a script. In this case, it's just, please check my YAML files if the syntax is correct. The lower part is nearly doing the same, except that instead of checking the YAML files, I'm doing a kubectl apply and applying those checked files onto my cluster. There are some Azure commands in front. It's mainly because it's running on an AKS, so managed Azure Kubernetes service. And I just log in with the Azure CLI, get my Kubernetes credentials, and use them in an authenticated way with kubectl. So just a basic pipeline, but just to give you some the basic stuff. Yeah, so the GitLab runner executor, how to get the workload into our Kubernetes cluster. So it's running itself in a pod, so you can install it with Helm, which is also automatable, deploy it on your cluster, and then you have one, or even you can scale it up, one pod running, which is just listening to your GitLab environment and waiting for pipeline jobs to run. Yeah, it itself then schedules a new pod if a pipeline job is running, and within the pod, there are different kinds of containers. First of all, it's somehow your build container, which is based on the image you defined, but there are also some service containers around, which then will be used in the different stages, perhaps for the pre-built stages, to clone your repo, to restore any kind of cache, or to write back the cache, to download or save artifacts. So this is service containers which run next to your build containers completely automatically. You don't need to do anything. Yeah, and then of course we have the build part, which then really runs your job or your image and your steps you defined in your pipeline. And if those finish successfully, the post build runs, which then would create caches, would upload artifacts, and stuff like this. Yes, so now I've short video which describes the stuff. Now here the first line is our GitLab runner executor which is running at the pod. And now we're seeing the other pods get started on the cluster. We're seeing the job is starting, and now we have here pods running with two containers with inside our building container and our service container. And the container is creating, then it's running, which means basically the container is up and our pipeline job itself is running. And then when the pipeline job finishes, we already see the green icon, the pods will be terminated and the next pods get started for the next pipeline run. In this case, deploy AKS, which is now running. And now it will take some seconds and then the pod gets terminated. Here we go, and we should see the green icon soon. Yeah, and then as last step, once again, we are deploying our YAML files, defining some basic configurations in our cluster. Pods are pending, they get created. They are running, and in some seconds, they get terminated, and some seconds later, the deploy YAML should be also green. It should get green. Perfect. So this example how really to run a whole pipeline on Kubernetes side, how it looks on the Kubernetes side. So then we talked about the stuff, how should we build our container images within our Kubernetes cluster. We could use Docker and Docker, which basically means you run the Docker command within a container. It's not the best solution because you either need to expose the Docker daemon or need to mount your varlib Docker directory, run it in privileged mode. There are different solutions, but everything is not really the best kind to do and not really secure. So I recommend to use the project called Koniko. It's part of the Knative build, which is the serverless stack on top of Kubernetes. And with Koniko, you can build your containers, images within a container without any dependencies and any need to run something in privileged mode. It's basically built by Google. It's itself running in a container, of course. This here is just an example how to run it plain on Kubernetes. So it's mainly the image, and then you just define some args. Where's your Docker file? Where's your context directory? And the destination. So destination is just any kind of Docker registry. You could also put in multiple destinations. And with this line, two lines, three lines, you can run your image build within your Kubernetes cluster. Of course, you can also speed up the stuff by using caching. We have with GitLab two options. We could either use GitLab caching itself or Koniko caching, which means Koniko would cache the different layers within the same Docker registry and just pull them every time to speed up the whole process. Yeah, here we have an example GitLab pipeline using Koniko. It's basically the same. We define one variable with our container image. It's really important in this case to use the debug tag because the normal Koniko image does not have any shell, and we need the shell to execute the steps below. So if you would like to use this, you need the debug tag, and then we're just creating a directory, defining our credentials for our registry. In this case, it's the registry of the project itself, so it just can use the variables. And then we have one line which just executes Koniko itself. We define the context, we define the Dockerfile location. In this case, I would like to cache that stuff and define the destination. And in this case, it's the same from the project, the registry, and define the name and the tag. And the pipeline will run and we'll build the image on our Kubernetes cluster without any privileges. Yeah, in this case, just an example for my demo later. So I'm building Azure CLI image, my YAML lint image, and then I'm using the Azure image as a base image for my Terraform image to also have the Azure CLI and my Terraform image for authentication, etc. Yeah, so an example pipeline. In this case, and I will show the share the code later for the whole example. So we are building or provision and update the Azure Kubernetes cluster, the managed Kubernetes in the Azure world, with any kind of dependencies, which means we will use Terraform to build up the cluster, and then running some default Kubernetes, or build some default Kubernetes resources like namespaces, ABAC, pod security policy, so basic security things which should be in place on any kind of cluster. So, which means we have four pipeline steps in this case. First of all, we're validating the Terraform code, then we're validating, or at the same time, we're validating the Kubernetes resources, then provision or update the cluster, depending on our change, and then apply or update the Kubernetes resources. Yeah, so have a look at the whole pipeline example. So first of all, once again, we have three different stages. We have some kind of variables. So we have the Azure authentication, which is stored in the variables of the project itself. And then we have, on the lower part, our three images we would like to use. And now we have our different, and I know it's pretty small, but as I said, I will show the code later. We're doing the Terraform validate, which is basically, first step is, of course, we're defining the tag Kubernetes to run our Kubernetes cluster. We're defining the image name. And then those lines are pretty logging into Azure and exporting configurations, definition, and secrets, mainly because I'm using Azure Vault to store my configuration and secrets. So just getting my secrets, which I need. And then initializing the Terraform project with Terraform init, defining my backend configuration for my state file, and then in the last line, just doing the Terraform validate with the information I need. And then Terraform will start, will validate our project, will tell us, hey, you have any kind of issues, or everything is fine. In the same time, we also, using our YAML lint image to check our Kubernetes resources. This one, it's pretty short. Also again, the Kubernetes tag, the image name, and just one line, just YAML lint, the YAML folder, and we'll check if the syntax is correct. After those both are passed, we go one step further and deploying our Terraform project. It's completely the same, except the last line, which is basically not a Terraform validate. It's just a Terraform plan to plan my deployment, and then Terraform apply to apply my changes. So it's basically the same. And then as last step, we are using our Azure image, authenticating against Azure, getting our Kubernetes credentials, and then just doing a kubectl config to define our current context, and then a kubectl apply and apply our change configuration files. So this is how we could build a Kubernetes cluster and define the basic resources completely containerized within another Kubernetes cluster. So this is, once again, this pipeline we talked about with the different steps. So first of all, we're doing the YAML lint. As you see, it's running on the GitLab runner with the Kubernetes tag. It's waiting for the pod to be up and running. Will take some seconds. Now it's running. We get our Git repo. We're doing the YAML lint, and the job is already done. Then for Terraform, it's nearly the same. It's already done again. And then we are getting the deployment. Once again, it's running in the pod. Will take some seconds to start. fetching our Git repo, and now Terraform is running and will tell us the changes and will apply the changes in a second. So this is Terraform init, and now it's doing apply. In this case, there was no change, and everything is fine. And then as last step, the Kubernetes resources. First step is authenticating, getting the credentials for a Kubernetes cluster and applying the resources. And it's also done. So in this way, it wasn't much changes. If you start up the new environment, that would have been done in, I don't know, 5 to 6 minutes, and you would have your fresh Kubernetes cluster defined with your resources, and the cluster would be up and running. So, so my slides are already online. If you would like to see them, the whole demo project, and I basically planned to do live demo, but this wasn't possible with the setup. So you will fill the whole project on GitLab. The first one, build shop image, is the pipeline to use Kaniko to run your build your container image. The deploy AKS, the project we saw in the slide before. And the last one is an optional project, so just spin up a Kubernetes cluster and deploy the GitHub runner to have some kind of Kubernetes cluster to run your workload. Yeah, so we're already at the end. 3 minutes left. Any questions? Okay, just repeating the question, if there any, if I have any issues with Kaniko at all, until now, no. So sometimes the build is a little bit too, little bit longer than normal, but not an issue at all in case that anything is not working, or so it's pretty nice. Yeah. Yeah. So I use the Kaniko version, which basically means it uses the same Docker registry and pull up another somehow image with all the cache Kaniko needs. No. In this case, the same registry you define. So in the project, I'm using the registry from the GitLab project, and I would have a second image, which is somehow called cache image, and within this Docker image, Kaniko would cache this stuff. So it's just a second Docker image in the same registry. And Kaniko will pull this image, extract the cache, building my image, and then uploading the image as well as uploading the cache. But you could also, with GitLab, you could also just use the GitLab cache, as you know it.
So it sounds like it's similar to doing a Docker pull before using that kind of method of caching.
Yeah, but with the Kaniko cache, you really have all, yeah, basically you have all layers, and they will put all the layers and different caching into one image. Yeah. But it's nearly the same like with Docker pull.
Time for maybe one more question if there's any another question? No?
Great. Okay.
Well, Nico, thank you so much. Really appreciate
it. You're welcome.